Let's connect the two functions in the middle so that it becomes a single smooth function. That's not quite smooth. Can we do better than that? So what is smoothness? There are many different notions of smoothness in mathematics, and there is an infinite family of smoothness that we want to consider for this video. And to understand what this means, let's start by looking at some examples. F of x is continuous, but it has a sharp corner, so it does not have a continuous first derivative. G of x is continuous, and it also has continuous first derivative, which is the same graph as f of x, so it does not have a continuous second derivative. We say f of x lives in C0, which is the space of continuous functions, but not C1, which is the space of continuously differentiable functions. And similarly, g lives in C0 and C1, but not in C2. In short, CK tells us how many continuous derivatives we can take. And C infinity means we can take derivative infinitely many times. And if a function lives in C infinity, we say that the function is smooth. So if we were to rank the smoothness class, including the usual notion of differentiability, continuity is the simplest, then differentiable, then having continuous first derivative, then second differentiable, then continuous second derivatives, and we can continue this pattern so on and so forth until we get to C infinity, which is the class of infinitely differentiable functions. Now, let's go back to our original problem. And the easiest way to interpolate between two points is a straight line. It is fairly straightforward to construct, as we have two points, which allows us to find the slope, and construct point-slope form. This function is continuous, but generally not continuously differentiable. In practice, linear interpolation is not good enough, and you can easily see that. So can we do any better? Since linear interpolation was only good up to continuity, we want to do a little bit better, maybe up to continuous differentiability. And if there exists such interpolation, both the function values and the first derivatives would have to match at the left and the right boundaries. So we need at least 4 degrees of freedom, and cubic polynomials have exactly 4 degrees of freedom. And using two function values and the two derivative values, we can set up a system of 4 linear equations with 4 variables, which is non-degenerate and is guaranteed to be uniquely solvable, as long as left and right endpoints are different. Cubic interpolation and its two-dimensional variant bicubic interpolation is used all the time in computer graphics, since our eyes are not very good at distinguishing smoothness over the first derivative. However, our body can tell that C1 is not smooth enough. To illustrate this point, let's assume that white dot is a car that is moving in constant speed. Initially, the car moves in a straight line, then it transitions to moving in a circular path. The blue vector represents velocity, and we see that it changes continuously, but the yellow vector, which represents acceleration, suddenly appears. In reality, that would be impossible since you would have to gradually turn the handle, but imagine that you are capable of turning your handle from 0 to 100 instantaneously. Doesn't sound too comfortable, does it? In practice, when designing mechanical devices, we have to make sure that the second derivative, or the acceleration, is continuous. In general, if we want to construct a polynomial interpolation that is continuous up to kth derivative, we can use the exact same technique as we did for cubic, by matching the function values and its derivatives up to kth derivatives. And that leaves us with 2k plus 2 unknowns, which we can solve with 2k plus 1 degree polynomial. And this technique goes by the name of Hermite interpolation, although his name really is supposed to be pronounced
Hermite,
since he is a French mathematician. We now have a method that can interpolate between any two functions that is continuous up to arbitrary kth derivative. And it raises the question whether we can come up with an interpolation that is smooth or infinitely differentiable. And the reasonable next step in our approach is to try using power series, since it would be the infinite limit of polynomials. However, if we know the values of derivatives of all order on the left boundary x equals a, then the power series is uniquely determined, and we call this the Taylor series of x at a. And similarly, we could do the same for the right endpoint x equals b. So this shows that power series is not the way to go, unless of course the left and the right function are the exact same analytic function, meaning a function can be represented by a single power series for the entire domain. Let's backtrack a little bit and try solving an easier problem. By interpolating between a constant function which takes the value 0 for x less than 0, and 1 for x greater than 1. There are many different ways to interpolate for each level of smoothness that we want. And of course, we can use Hermite polynomials to do the job. Now, let's construct a function phi which takes the value 0 for x less than 0, 1 for x greater than 1, and is continuous and monotone increasing in the middle. We call phi the step function, and we can take 1 minus phi, and we call this the cutoff function. I chose phi to be a linear step function for now, but it can be anything as long as it satisfies continuity and monotonicity. Now, let f and g be any smooth function, and we can construct a special function h, which is f times the cutoff function plus g times the step function. If we think of x as the time, we can intuitively think of this as turning off the function f and turning on the function g from time 0 to 1. Notice how the function h is only smooth as the step function, which is continuous but not differentiable. If we instead choose our step function to be in c1, then so is our h function. So if we can somehow come up with this smooth step function, then we solved our problem. For those of you who are students of college level mathematical analysis, you may have noticed that I have skipped some key details in my argument, and I think this is a great time to pause to look at some important theorems. The first theorem says that if f is k times differentiable, then the derivative of f is k minus 1 times differentiable. And similarly, if f is in ck, then f prime is in ck minus 1. And lastly, if f is infinitely differentiable, then so is f prime. The next theorem comes in 3 different versions as well, for each different notion of smoothness. And this theorem says that if f and g are in certain smoothness class, then so is the linear combination of f and g. Meaning we can add 2 functions, or multiply them by constants, and the level of smoothness is preserved. It is very common to prove this theorem for k equals 1 case in the first course in calculus. And to prove the differentiability, we just have to show that the limit of the difference quotient exists. But it is often written as 2 separate rules, called sum rule and constant multiple rule. And for arbitrary higher derivatives, it is not too hard to see that similar formula holds. Next theorem says that different level of smoothness of 2 functions is preserved by taking products. And for k equals 1 case, we call this the product rule. And to come up with the general formula, we can try looking at the pattern for next couple of values of k. And we can see that formula is almost like binomial expansion. Now, we have all the tools to justify that the smoothness of h depends on the smoothness of the step function. Since h can be written as sums and products of f, g, and phi, h is only smooth as the least smooth of the 3. And if phi is smooth, then h is smooth as well. Now, we want to construct a step function that is smooth. And in order to do that, there is one more theorem I need to introduce. If f and g are in certain smoothness class, then the composition of f and g is in the same class as well. And for k equals 1 case, we call it the chain rule. And there is a formula for higher k as well, but it is too big to fit in the margin of the slide. And for interested audience, it goes by the name of Fa di Bruno's formula. For the purpose of this video, I will not prove these 4 theorems. But for the interested audience, sketch up the proof for the infinitely differentiable case is in link in the description below. I do want to look at one very important application to the theorems. The reciprocal of f is as smooth as the function f itself as long as f does not equal 0. This really just is application of function composition rule. And from this, along with the product rule, it is not too hard to see that quotient of 2 functions is just as smooth as the numerator and the denominator functions, as long as denominator does not equal 0. Now we have all the tools, we can construct some special functions. Let psi be a smooth function on the closed interval 0 to 1. And any notion of differentiability at endpoints typically doesn't make sense, as it's typically taught in the first course of calculus. However, since derivative is a limit, if we restrict our domain to a closed interval, we can say that the derivative exists as long as the one-sided limit exists. We also want to make sure that the psi is monotone increasing, and the psi of 0 equals 0. Then, we can construct phi from psi, and phi satisfies some important properties. The first property states that the phi is also smooth from the closed interval 0 to 1, and the second property says that phi of 0 equals 0, and phi of 1 is equal to 1. And the third property says that the phi is monotone increasing. The next 2 properties are the most important, and they will be revealed after the first 3 properties are proved, so please stay tuned. The proof of the first property is quite simple, as phi is made up of sum, composition, and quotients of psi, which is smooth. And the denominator part, which I will call h of x, never equals 0. In order to see that the second property holds, phi of 0 makes the numerator equal to 0, and phi of 1 makes the numerator and the denominator equal. Next, in order to show that the phi is monotone increasing, we just have to show that the derivative for all values of x in between 0 to 1 is non-negative. Psi is monotone increasing, and it is also non-negative since it starts at 0. So once we compute the derivative for phi using quotient rule and simplify it, we can see that all the parts that make up the numerator are non-negative, and the denominator part, which we decided to call h, is positive. So this shows that phi prime is non-negative, or in other words, phi is monotone increasing. Now, to the long-awaited fourth property, phi is symmetric about the order pair 1/2, 1/2. Or equivalently, if we shift the function down by 1/2 and left by 1/2, then the function is odd. In order to see that the transformed function is odd, we will first make each part have common denominator and collect like terms. Let's temporarily call this transform function theta of x, and now we can evaluate theta of negative x, and that should come out to negative theta of x, which proves the odd symmetry of the transform function. The most important fifth property says that if the kth derivative of psi at 0 is equal to 0 for all k less than or equal to n, then all kth derivative of phi of 0 is also equal to 0. This one is particularly useful property since it tells us that the local behavior of phi at 0 is almost identical to the local behavior of psi at 0. And furthermore, by the symmetry property, all the derivatives of phi at 1 for k from 1 to n is also equal to 0. And this allows us to create a step function of arbitrary smoothness much more efficiently than using Hermite polynomials. In order to see that this property holds, we can let the denominator part of phi to be theta, which is a smooth function since the denominator never equals 0. And for any k less than or equal to n, the kth derivative of phi can be written as a linear combination of derivatives of order less than or equal to k of psi, which are all individually equal to 0. So, kth derivative of phi at 0 is equal to 0. Now, there is a slight variant of this property which states that if the derivatives of all order of psi at 0 is equal to 0, then same holds for phi. I'm not going to prove this part, but it just requires adding mathematical induction to the finite version of the argument. Now, we really almost are done, we just have to find an appropriate psi to get phi, which is the non-constant part of the step function. And in order to find that psi that we want, let us temporarily look at e to the x. And this function is particularly interesting since derivatives of all order is equal to e to the x, so the limit of derivative of all order as x goes to negative infinity is equal to 0. And we can come up with a function that captures the behavior at negative infinity and shifts it to 0. The one-sided derivatives of all orders of psi function at 0 is equal to 0. And intuitions aside, that is a fairly technical argument to prove, and I will leave the proof in the link in the description below. And using psi, we can construct phi, and once we extend the domain of phi to include the constant portions, then phi is a smooth step function. Now we have the tools to smoothly interpolate between any two functions from 0 to 1, but can we change the domain of transition of the step function to two arbitrary real numbers a and b? And yes, we just have to compose phi with the linear function that takes a to 0 and b to 1. Now that we have solved our problem that we have set out to solve, can we maybe generalize this to a smooth interpolation problem in higher dimension or in a smooth manifold?